Before we get into today's webinar, we'll give a little bit of an update of what's happening around HPA at the moment. So if we just jump over to my screen, I have this photo up, and this is the Honda City endurance car, Honda City race car that we have. This is the staff race car coming up the Coronet Peak Hill Climb. So this was an event put on by the Queenstown Car Club and sponsored by us here at High Performance Academy over the last weekend. So this is our Honda City race car, a little bit of a different type of build. If you're not familiar with it, we don't discuss it too often, although you can see it in some of our other content. And it's a slowly developing thing, but it's made a little bit of a jump in the last week or so. This is a Honda City, I think late 80s, early 90s, don't quote me on that. Originally intended to just be a simple D-series, D16 kind of build, pretty stock body, roll cage, just something we can go to the track in, but you know how things go, a little bit of scope creep, and we've ended up at something quite different a few years later. So this is currently powered by a B18CR out of a Honda Integra DC2 Type R, and it has the S80 I think LSD gearbox out of that with a clutch type 1.5 way LSD, and it actually has the uprights, so McPherson struts front suspension with the uprights out of a Toyota Corolla or Levin chassis of AE101. So a little bit of a Frankenstein of parts in the front end, but it all works. And then, as you can see, we'll get to another picture. There's quite an aggressive body kit on it, kind of a TCR styling, and that is because this is some of this body kit is taken directly from a TCR VW Golf GTI race car, or VW Golf TCR race car. So these rear arches you can see here, and the wing as well, and then this front kit is actually a bit of a custom job made from a few different things, and then we took our mold of this, and this is all carbon fiber, the kind of front clip here, so the arches and the front bumper. And then obviously the inside of it, which I don't actually have any photos of, is full roll cage, motorsport style pedal box with a bias bar, and it's running a race ECU. It's been a bit of work to get it to this stage, but the boys basically did a lot of work last week. It just got painted in this Nardo grey colour. Then we got a bit of a wrap on there as well. And Marco and Brandon did a bit of a test day last week at our local, one of our local tracks here, just about 2 hours drive away in Teretonga, near Invercargill, bottom of the South Island of New Zealand. Then the hill climb in the weekend. It was reasonably successful. They got some good runs up there, but just a few CV issues, and then a little bit of some trigger issues because some recent changes that were made to it are kind of preventing some of the best runs at the end there. But definitely a potent little package and a lot of room for development left, and it's looking like it should be really good. So we'll keep you updated on that with any changes in the future. So just moving on from that, still on my screen here, we've got the giveaway happening at the moment. So there's 8 days left to enter for this, and I'll get Geordie to drop the link for this into the chat, so you can follow that. Come along here, it's completely free to enter. And this is for the prize this week, or these 2 weeks, is the Blink Marine RacePad. So we'll get to that in a moment. And it also comes with an HPA VIP package as well. So a bunch of our courses. So if we jump to the overhead camera, I've got the Blink Marine RacePad here. And essentially this is a CAN keypad that mounts to the steering wheel, making all the buttons easy to reach. And We have, yeah, there's eight buttons here and four rotary knobs as well, and everything is, you can configure it any way you want. It's all customizable, the where the buttons are, the different icons, and also down to the color of the LEDs and things like that. So back on the computer screen here, this is on the Blink Marine site. You can see it there, and then I also have some photos of it here. So it mounts to, kind of designed to mount to a typical three spoke. That's a Racetech steering wheel there. But the basically the backing pad that clamps it to the steering wheel will allow it to be mounted to lots of different designs as well. So don't feel like you would have to go and buy a new steering wheel if you don't have a suitable one. And you can see all the LEDs and stuff lit up there. So a nice little CAN keypad, mounts directly to the steering wheel, and yeah, jump along to that link that Geordie dropped in the chat and you can enter there, completely free to enter. And there's also that suite of HPA courses as well. So moving on from that, I'll just jump over to our YouTube channel, and this is pretty relevant to today's discussion around CAD sheet metal work. So when I was at SEMA last year, I had this chat to Jim from SendCutSend, and talked about SendCutSend, but also a lot of kind of sheet metal specific design for manufacturing things as well. So SendCutSend, for those who aren't aware, they're based in the US, I think, or Canada, North America anyway, and they are a online manufacturing service for sheet metal components. And they kind of started out just doing laser cutting and things like that, but they've also jumped into a lot of other areas or provided a lot more services as well, such as CNC bending for the sheet metal parts, and finishing processes like powder coating, things like that, and also tapping holes and a whole bunch of stuff. And they have a really good platform working there where they can recommend material types and all sorts of different things as well. So with Jim here, I discussed a lot of things around what it takes to actually not only design a part, but then from moving from there into getting the part manufactured. That's a step that often introduces a lot of problems for people, and there are some design for manufacturing or DFM considerations around that as well. So we talk about that, we talk about which type of files you need and some other things as well. So I'd recommend jumping along to that and having a bit of a listen if you're interested in using their services or just interested in designing sheet metal parts for your race car. As we know, sheet metal parts can be a really valuable tool to use in race cars because it allows us to create quite nice, strong and stiff parts at a relatively low cost compared to something like machined parts or even 3D printed in some cases. So moving on from that, just also relevant to that is our CAD course. For those who aren't aware, we have our 3D modeling and CAD for motorsport course, and we also have a forum set up for that as well, so people taking that course can jump into that forum and ask any technical questions they have or projects they're working on. And we also share some other links and that to places like SendCutSend or Zometry or services like that that offer things like online CNC manufacturing processes. But also, so in that CAD course, we kind of focus, we're using Fusion 360 as the program in that for all the examples, but anything in that course, we teach the fundamentals of modeling in any CAD software. So anything in that course is completely transferable to any other program, which you'll see hopefully in SolidWorks today. There are a lot of similarities between all the programs, and once you know how to use one, you definitely know how to use all of them. It just takes a little bit of time to adjust to the other programs. But yeah, so we teach the fundamentals in that and how to model anything to get a really good understanding from it. And then in these webinars, we also have worked examples attached to that course for more in-depth worked examples, some really big projects, Like recently, we just done a CNC valve cover for the SR20 VET engine in our Toyota 86 race car. So that's quite an intense, in-depth modeling process. That's in the CAD course, but we're also doing these webinars to show some other programs how things relate, and also a little bit of a demonstration of and some other topics in these webinars to show how you can quickly model quite simple parts, give you a bit of an insight into these different parts that are a bit more simple, a few different areas and different programs as well. So moving on from that, in terms of our courses, our most recent one has gone up, and this is our braking system design and optimization course. So again, I'll get Geordie to drop the link to this in the chat, and we have our Cyber Monday sale going at the moment, so this is heavily discounted there, 50% off. And this course kind of dives deep into everything about motorsport braking systems, but completely applicable to anything performance-based in a road car as well. We talk about, I'll just scroll down here to the curriculum. So we talk about the fundamental principles that automotive braking systems work on, things like hydraulics, brake friction, things like brake bias as well, that are very important to understand if you're working with braking systems in a performance application. We also talk about brake system components. So that's all the components that could be involved in a motorsport style braking system. Then we move on to how the critical measurements we need to take. So that's temperature measurements, pressure measurements, and position measurements. And those position measurements are usually of the master cylinder travel. So those are the measurements that we need to take and understand to be able to analyze the performance of our braking system. Moving on, we have our braking system design modules. So this is how to do all of the calculations you'd need to be able to design a system from scratch, or just modify an existing system, or even analyze an existing system, understand its drawbacks, and understand if you change certain things, what impact that would have. We'll come back to this in just a moment with the brake system calculator. But after that, we jump into some practical skills here. So we've got everything from brake bleeding, brake bedding, all the way through to upgrading calipers and changing master cylinders, and then as well as like tuning brake temperature, troubleshooting common issues as well. And then we wrap that up at the end into a simple three-step process that kind of guides you on the rough way you should tackle any brake problems that you have, or the design of a braking system from scratch. So just jumping back to that brake system design section here, you can see we have the brake calculator, HPA brake calculator. And this is being worked on at the moment to eventually go onto our website. But this is essentially what we have at the moment, is this spreadsheet. So this allows you to input your car data that is has an influence over the braking performance of the vehicle. So we've got things there like the wheelbase, the mass, how it's distributed, center of gravity height as well, tires, and the braking package. So that's the components like the size of the calipers, the pistons in the caliper, the size of the brake disc, and then the types of pads that we're using, along with a lot of other information as well, all to paint a picture of the brake setup. And then the calculator goes through these intermediate calculations, and at the end it will recommend master cylinder sizes that are ideal for that. But that's definitely not the limitation of this. This isn't just for recommending master cylinder sizes. It will really allow you to experiment with different size braking discs and pistons in the calipers, things like different tires and stuff as well, and different compounds, and then how the dimensions of the vehicle and things like that affect the braking performance as well. So you can really start from scratch and design a system, or you could analyze a current system using this and experiment with changes to any of these components to see how it will change the performance. And that's really all shown down here on this brake bias plot. So this gives a bit of a visual representation of how the actual brake bias compares to, which essentially means that the balance of the car in the end of it under the brakes, and how that compares to a theoretically optimal system. Of course, there's a lot more to it that we cover in the course around tuning temperatures, things like compliance, and just general pedal feel, things like that. On that note, this is actually something that's kind of factored into this calculator. We have some things about pedal travel and effort here, as well as some warnings it can give you if it looks like something is going to be a significant issue. But once we get down to this brake bias plot, this blue line here shows us the actual calculated brake bias. And then this black line here would be the theoretical optimal here. So this shows how the forward bias, so the brake bias of the vehicle, the requirement for it changes with the deceleration rate. So basically, the harder we brake, the more the load is transferred onto the front wheels and off the rear wheels. So generally speaking, the more front bias that we require. So that's why we kind of have this linear increase in the bias here. If we're in this red zone here, we've generally got too much rearward bias. Anything in the green zone is within about 7% of that theoretical optimal, so that's pretty good. And then in this grey zone, we're kind of in the overly forward bias zone, which tends to be a lot more stable and lead to understeer compared to overly rear bias, which will lock the rear wheels first and would make the car rotate on corner entry. But if you're up in this grey area, you're often leaving a lot of braking performance on the table. So in this case, we've got this blue line, and this is actually shown with the use of a proportioning valve as well. So it kind of varies the brake pressure to the rear brakes depending on the input pressure. Otherwise, it would be a dead straight line across, and then these two light blue lines show the amount of adjustment that we would have with our brake bias bar, so can move it essentially anywhere in that range. But yeah, that is our brake course, so I recommend going over, checking that out. Like all our other courses, we have a forum set up for that as well, where we can answer any questions that you might have, any technical details that you want to dive deeper into, and just general discussion with other people working on braking system projects on their own vehicles, and any issues or things that they're finding out as they go. So I'll leave it at that and just get my notes together, and I'll be back in a few moments with today's webinar.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.